topic that we're going to discuss will be looking at a variety of issues around the opportunities presented by the digital age for freedom of expression. We're going to talk a little bit about citizen journalism. We're going to talk about crisis mapping and tools that we can use to monitor and assess what's happening with free expression. And we're also going to move into the virtual world and think a little bit about how game playing and virtual realms can help us think about and promote free expression in the digital age. So the panellists are going to talk for about 15 minutes each, and then we will open the discussion up. I'm also hopeful in a sort of digital outreach kind of way that we can do some sort of digital hello to the Wikimania conference, which is happening in London at the end of the session. So we'll maybe think about how we can do some sort of a collective hello to that, because it seems to me that often these discussions happen potentially in a little bit of a digital bubble, and it would be great to start to see how we can bring them together so that we can be even more powerful. So on my far right, I'm delighted to welcome Hisham Almiraat, Director of Global Voices Advocacy. Global Voices is an international community of bloggers, citizen journalists who report via blogs and about citizen media in order to raise the profile and increase the impact of those individuals. Hisham himself writes about Morocco, North Africa and online freedom of speech. He won Deutsche Welle's Best of Blogs competition for his blog talkmorocco.net and co-founded Mantha Kinch, which won the Breaking Borders Award in support of online free expression. He's also a medical doctor, so if you have any medical ailments, in that spirit of are there any doctors on the plane, we have one here. Anahi Ayala Iacucci is Senior Innovation Advisor for Internews. She specialises in information and communication technologies for development, which includes crisis mapping. She manages pilot projects across Africa, the Middle East, Asia and Eurasia that look at using technology to overcome communication barriers. She's co-founder of the Standby Task Force, which is an online volunteer community for live mapping, and they manage the Libya crisis project. And finally, Richard Bartle is a British writer, professor, and game researcher. He has a doctorate in artificial intelligence from the University of Essex, and he's the co-creator of the original MUD program, which is the piece of technology, a piece of software behind multiplayer virtual worlds. He's also researched, and I think this is really interesting also for us to think about later, personality types in huge multiplayer games. There are four types, I'm giving the game away slightly. Shall I not say?
It's okay, I can talk about that.
There are four types, which I'll let him tell you about, but perhaps afterwards it might be interesting to think which one of those we all fit into, which I think is very intriguing. Hisham,
okay.
The floor is yours.
So I'll stand up. That's the old demagogue in me, as I once heard Christopher Hitchens say, actually. So I work for Global Voices, as has been said, and for the last 2 years, actually, I've been basically following all that is worse about the internet, the threats, violations of human rights, imprisonments, and in some cases, unfortunately, an increasing number of cases, people being killed because of their use of the internet for some kind of civic engagement, some kind of political forum. So when I was asked actually to come and talk about the freedom of expression, freedom of thought in the digital age, I thought, well, surely I will be able or allowed to also talk about, you know, what I do most of the time. And they told me actually, no, actually, there is another session for that. And you need to put aside all the threats, and I thought they must be crazy. But you know, the more I thought about it, the more I found the exercise actually very interesting. And I, as has been said, I come from a completely different sphere of interest. I am a medical doctor, so I always had this gut feeling somehow that the internet was kind of special. It is a medium, but not only a medium of communication. It was kind of special, and I had this gut feeling that it needed a special protection, a special promotion. And for some reason, that gut feeling you know, increasingly is kind of reinforced by the way I see the internet used around me. I mingle with activists, very brave people in very difficult environments who have kind of embraced the internet and, you know, relatively found a way to use it in a very effective manner. So, well, let's say, for the sake of the argument, let me be deliberately optimistic today, and I expect the audience to challenge me on my assumptions. I'm not going to be, you know, I speak for myself, but I'm sure my co-panelists will not be deterministic in terms of their view of technology. You know, I personally don't think that the internet is a force strictly for either the good or the bad, and we'll come to that later. So why is the internet important for political activism? You know, I thought about this question for a long time, and I came up with a couple of reasons for that, very good reasons, and you know, and based on experience and based on examples and real life experiences with the internet. The first one is, and since we are in this wonderful gathering of freethinkers, atheists, and humanists, I think the internet is a wonderful matchmaker, a wonderful tool for mass collaboration and mass mobilization. I wouldn't have been here, I suspect, if there was no internet. In Oxford, I met with two fellow countrymen who also happened to be humanists, like myself. And we needed to come here to be able to meet. And there is an idea that is brewing right now. We are, you know, contemplating a project. We want to start, or try at least to start, a local chapter in Morocco of the, you know, humanists. And of the humanist association and humanist movement. And I think that because the internet, you know, is so ubiquitous and allows people somehow safely, offers a safe space for many people to express their views relatively safely, that allows many people who think alike, who have similar political views and ideologies, to come together. Of course, there is a downside of that, and sometimes we find ourselves preaching to the choir, and preaching to the converted. But there is also a very good quality to that, and it allows people to come together. In the case of the Arab Spring, for example, you know, I can already hear you say that, you know, there were, and it's probably true, there were underlying socioeconomic issues and historical issues and political issues and factors that were that played a very crucial role in fueling the revolutions in early 2011, and it started in Tunisia, as everybody knows. But they cannot be, in my view, completely understood or appreciated without reference to the unprecedented role, as far as I'm concerned, of social media. And I was there, sleepless, I was so excited, following tweets and blog posts from my country, and I was at the time in France, in the safety of the Western world, watching things happening back in my region. And we were able to follow, to support, and to understand what was going on. And I, from experience as well, I mean, it's very, it's not scientific, but that's my personal experience. A lot of people in the middle class, people who would otherwise be completely indifferent to the plight of their countrymen, because of the internet, because of social media, felt that they had a common cause. And for some reason, we, in Tunisia in particular, and in Egypt at least in the beginning, because of the internet, we reached a critical mass that made the revolution, unstoppable. It may have, without the internet, it may probably have happened later on in the history of the Middle East. But I like this metaphor that I heard once, The internet is like an engine that you put, a Formula One engine that you put in a very old car, and that car is the Arab Revolution. It was progressing, there was something happening, and people were, I mean, that's history. You cannot oppress people indefinitely. People were at some point going to revolt, etc. But the internet made it easy and made it much more probable and organized. We can talk about, of course, what happened afterwards, but that's for another. That's another debate. The other thing that, from my experience, I think is a cause for optimism as far as the internet is concerned, is that it's virtually uncensorable. Quite controversial statement to make, but in China, for example, you know, the state spends billions, probably, in maintaining an army of censors, the duty of which is, you know, uniquely to monitor the internet. That's a huge task. That's really something that costs a lot, and it's difficult. And yet, we still can get information out of China, despite of the wall. In the Arab world as well, censorship and blocking of websites has been going on for a long time, but it has been a complete failure, because today everybody has become a potential journalist. People do their investigation themselves, and I myself, you know, very modestly have been involved with a group of people in Morocco. Morocco is not the kind of country that you hear about in the news. That's a good thing, but the bad thing is that it's as oppressive as any other country in that region. We have a monarch in Morocco that is kind of a pope. He's an executive monarch. Every kind of media, traditional media, is state owned, and so-called independent journalists, you know, most of the time, they practice self-censorship for fear of being prosecuted. So in the case of Morocco, we just decided, well, why not start our own news agency? And we started a website called Manfakinch, which in Moroccan Arabic means we won't give up. And it was a huge success because it offered an alternative to official media. And it was a great success because there was people were thirsty about this kind of you know, unfiltered information. We were attacked many times. You know, I remember very well in a bright morning in July 2012, receiving a very enticing email in my inbox talking about some kind of scandal and actually prompting me to open a file, a Word file, that, you know, ended up containing a very sophisticated, very expensive piece of technology that kind of invites itself into your computer and then records all your keyboard strikes and can activate your camera surreptitiously, can activate your microphone, etc. But that didn't stop us actually from continuing the battle. And there is always a way to circumvent these kind of mean attacks. And I think the governments, oppressive governments in general, have learned that lesson more than anybody else. And you know, there is an organization based in London actually that monitors you know, surveillance, electronic surveillance around the world, and those countries, despite their despite poverty, despite a very low GDP, most of the cases spend millions of dollars of taxpayers' money to acquire you know, surveillance technology, and that shows that they have understood that the internet was disruptive, and that the internet could potentially destroy old structures of repression and dictatorship. The other reason is in terms of governance. We have a stake in making the internet stay free and fair for everybody, and we can still, to this day, participate in the internet governance process. It is a truly multi-stakeholder process, although some would say that it's dominated by governments and the private sector. But, you know, still, as humanists, for example, it's a shame that in the IGF, which is the International Governance Forum, that will be held in a couple of days in Turkey, in Istanbul, I am not aware of any humanist movement that will be present in Istanbul, actually, to watch and challenge and you know, have a say on how the internet is governed in order to guarantee that the internet stays free. But that's a possibility, that's an option that we have. Another argument that I would put forth is the fact that the internet allowed the idea of open knowledge and open government. I think it's tremendously important. In the case of open knowledge, I mean, take the case of Wikipedia. That's wonderful. That's a miracle. Well, you know, it's not in religious terms, of course, but I mean, the power of truth, the power of facts, etc. That's accessible to anybody around the world, thanks to the internet. Open government as well. You can take governments to task because they are forced to put public data online, and that potentially gives power to the citizen. They can go, they can consult public data, they can investigate based on data alone. And my final argument is citizen journalism. We've seen since the beginning of the internet and through revolutions in Ukraine, revolutions in the Arab world, etc., how, you know, in a very spontaneous way, people, you know, instead of waiting for the media to do their job, became themselves the media and used the internet in a great way. Well, to conclude, and of course we will open the floor to questions and, you know, please challenge us on our assumptions. Of course there are overly simplified conclusions about the role of social media and the internet in general. Wa'il Ghunim, I don't know if you guys are familiar with him. I mean, this was the leader in Egypt, the guy who worked with Google. He said, if you want to liberate society, just give them the internet. That's what he said. Another, that was quoted by Morozov, you know, that he's an author. He wrote the book, The Net Delusion, quoted someone saying that democracy is just a tweet away. Nicholas Kristof, the very celebrated New York Times columnist, said that the internet is the quintessential 21st century conflict. I must admit, I don't agree. It's not as easy as it sounds, although it's empowering. You know, the advent of the print press in the 15th century played a crucial role in weakening the power of the medieval church and led to the Renaissance, and later to the Reformation and scientific revolution. However, it took centuries before we could realize that actually the printing press had such power. You know, attempting to do the same with the internet while it's still in its infancy is difficult and should be very careful. We should be careful, very careful about that. But we must recognize that it has a potential to be disruptive, to be transformative. And as humanists here, I basically invite you, everybody, to use it. It's like a megaphone. It carries whatever you decide to say or say aloud. So if we don't use it, it's not going to be for any great use. We can make it potentially, a tool for enlightenment on steroids, if you like. We can use it for inserting truth, because I think that truth is on the side of humanists as opposed to superstition-based religions and, Bronze Age religions. So there are a lot of exciting times ahead. There is a latent revolution happening because of the internet, that's my belief. And I invite you all to join that revolution. Thank you very much.
That was very inspiring.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
So what I'm going to be doing is actually show just some examples of how I have seen in the course of my work people using different type of technologies to speak up. And it's going to be different type of examples from different parts of the world in completely different context. Now, the reason why I wanted, I don't know why it's like all trembling, but okay. The reason why I think, and I think Hisham thinks that too, that we are actually looking at a revolution is because, at least from my perspective, I've been working I've worked with an organization that works with journalists. And journalists grow up, especially in the past 30 years, with the conviction that they are the gatekeepers of information in a way. They investigate, they take information from governments, from authorities, they look at what's happening, and they are the main channel through which those information are spread in the world. Now, with the digital revolution, they don't have that role anymore, because nowadays everybody can do that. I can go around, I can take a picture with my phone, I can edit it if I want it, I can put it on my blog and publish it, and millions of people around the world can come and see. I can write my opinion, I can do investigative pieces by myself. I don't need to be a journalist. And this means that in a way, we're looking at a democratization of information. Of course, this is also coming with risks and with a lot of problems and issues, and I don't think that there's means that the role of journalists is not there anymore. I think that is just changing a lot. But what is fascinating for me is to, part of my job is to look at how communities on the ground are harvesting the power of technology and really trying to change dynamics. Not just dynamics in between communities, but dynamics in between communities and governments or between communities and institutions. The first example that I want to talk about is Haiti. I've been involved in Haiti just after the earthquake. Internews' organization was working in the country. We were providing emergency information to the affected population. Now, most of the time when I talk about emergencies, people kind of like look at me and say, well, what does this has to do with freedom of speech? Well, one of the things that, and I don't know if many of you have experience in that, but one of the things that I notice in years of working in humanitarian emergencies is that the humanitarian ecosystem is very much a dictatorship. What happened is that there is an emergency, everything gets destroyed, like for example in Haiti, the earthquake destroyed almost everything, and the humanitarian community arrives in the country and act as a government. They provide services. They decide which services are going to be available to whom. They decide when those services are going to be available, and in a way, they really act as a government, but they're not elected. They're not accountable to anyone in a way because they are funded by external donors. They're funded either by other countries or by the United Nations, which is also funded by countries. So in a way, they are total dictatorship imposed on a sector of the population within a certain country. Now, of course, they're there because they want to do good and they have principles that they have to respect. But if they don't do it, it's very hard to hold them accountable. And on the other side, even if they do it, they're not necessarily forced to talk to the affected population to understand if what they're providing to them is something that they actually really want. So one of the very interesting things that happened in Haiti immediately after the earthquake, and I have to point out that the main UN operation inside Haiti that was there since many years got also completely destroyed. So also the humanitarian community didn't have a reference immediately in the country to be able to start its operation. But Carol Pad, who's a journalist from Radio One in Haiti, basically had, you know, he was in his house when the earthquake happened. It happened during the night, that's why it had so many victims. And he immediately jumped on a car and decided to go back to the radio. And while he was driving to the radio, he was eyewitnessing around himself, you know, people dead in the street, everybody in panic, the entire city of destroyed. And when he arrived at the radio station, he realized that the question that he had were also the question that the people, the other people had. And so he basically started looking for emergency information and sharing them on Twitter. Now, one of the things that it was very interesting to me is that normally the humanitarian community doesn't share their information with the affected population. They come in, they say, this is a refugee camp, you go into a refugee camp, we'll give you a tent, we'll give you food, and you stay here. if you have questions about what's happening in my village, do you know if my house was destroyed? Do you know if someone in my family has been killed? For the humanitarian community being a huge institution, it's really hard to answer those questions, and they don't normally do it because they don't have the time to do it. They're too busy setting up the camps and providing food and so on. And that's what he started doing, though. He actually started providing people with information about, you know, people were tweeting or calling in the radio and asking him, do you know if someone is alive there? And he was tweeting the message out or saying it at the radio and saying, if anyone is in that part of the city, can they come here or tell us or let us know if everybody is okay there, how many houses collapsed? So in a way, it was a very interesting thing to eyewitness because it was the first time where someone from the affected population started providing and processing information and communicating with the rest of the population about an emergency completely separated from what the humanitarian community was doing, at the point that weeks later, UN OCHA and other members of the humanitarian community went to Karel and asked him, can we use your Twitter feed to send information out to the local community? Because this is a very useful tool and you know how to use it. A second example is a project that I worked on in Egypt. It was a project that I worked on in 2011. It was the parliamentary election. It was still under the Mubarak regime, just before the revolution. And the context at the time was that in Egypt there were lots of activists that were very tech-savvy. They were using Facebook, they were using Twitter, they were using YouTube videos. A lot of them were ending up in jail, being tortured. A lot of them disappeared and were never found. And at a certain point, they started talking with Freedom House, an American organization, a watchdog human rights organization, and they asked them to support them to create a system to monitor the parliamentary election. Mubarak had forbidden to anyone to monitor the election, including international observers, so it was illegal in the country to monitor the election. So the way we did it was that we looked at the context of the country and we said, well, there's a lot of bloggers, there's a lot of social media activists, there's a lot of people on Twitter, on YouTube, there's a lot of people with mobile phones. Why we don't monitor the elections? And so we trained around 250, 300 activists around the entire country in using the tools that they were already using to monitor the electoral campaign and then the actual elections. They collected more than 2,700 reports, including videos of violations, pictures of people outside the polling station giving money to people, telling them what to vote. And it was extremely interesting in that sense because, again, it was the local population. It was young Egyptians that were monitoring their own elections, and they managed to do it in a way where that international organization would have never managed to do because they would have been too visible. And in this sense, what was also very interesting is that the Mubarak regime was very good in monitoring and surveilling this kind of systems. But despite that, they couldn't really stop it because there were too many people that were part of the system. They would have had to shut down the entire internet and the mobile system to be able to actually shut down the project. We had several platforms on several URL on the internet so that if they shut down one website, we could have immediately other three coming out. We had more than 15 phone numbers set up so that people could text whatever number, and if the national security found one and shut it down, we would have another SIM card immediately activated to collect other type of information. A second project, and that's not really a project, that's just an observation. I lived in Kenya for 4 years working for Internews as Innovation Advisor for Africa, and I was out of the country when the Westgate attack happened in 2013, I guess, it was not last year. I don't know if any of you knows about it or remembers. It was a group of Al-Shabaab terrorists that went into one of the biggest mall in Nairobi, and they basically took the mall for 4 days. We still don't know how many people died in that attack, and the response from the national security in Kenya was, I would say, extremely strange, at least, in the sense that nobody really knew what the police was doing. The army got involved. There was army, or at least there were rumors of Israeli intelligence army that was brought on the side to support the Kenyan army in responding to the emergency. What happened was that after the 4 days of emergency, and when finally the emergency happened, there was no real number about how many people actually died. And a lot of surveillance video from inside the mall starting to be published by journalists. And those videos were showing the same Kenyan police and Kenyan army looting the place and setting things on fire. Things that they had accused the terrorists to do during the 4 days attack. Of course, you can imagine the outrage of the Kenyan population. One of the things, there were two very interesting things that happened. One was that during the attack, a lot of youth in Kenya that were on Twitter created an hashtag, a specific hashtag called We Are One. And the meaning of the hashtag We Are One started because they wanted to, you know, show that they were all in solidarity. One of the very interesting things that happened under the hashtag We Are One is that when it became clear that those were Al-Shabaab fighters, and so those were Somali Muslims that were carrying on the attack, some people starting to write very racist and very offensive messages on the We Are One Twitter feed. And what happened was that the majority of the people in the feed basically pushed them out and said, we don't want to have this conversation. We don't want to transform this into a conversation in between Christians and Muslims or Kenyans and Somali. Those are crazy terrorists that are killing innocent people. This is what we want to talk about. If you want to use this conversation to incite violence or incite hatred against a specific group, either religious or ethnic, you're not welcome. You should leave this conversation. The second thing that happened was that some of the people in that Twitter feed decided to create a Google Doc. So an online Google Doc open to everybody. In the first 10 minutes in which this Google Doc was created, there were at least 75 people that were already editing it. And the only thing that the person that set it up said is, let's just write down the questions that we have for our government. The question that we want to ask the Kenyan government to answer about the way they are responding to this emergency. And it was fascinating to see. This document collected around 87 different questions that goes from why the government was so late in responding to what is the government intending to do with the police that actually looted the place, and is it really true that after the first day everybody was already dead or there were still people trapped into it. There were a lot of very interesting questions that the population was asking directly to the Kenyan government. Now, the bad side of it is that the Kenyan government completely ignored this. But to me, what is still fascinating and interesting is that technology has allowed something like this to happen, which is the collective gathering and conversation of people talking about an event in their country and being able to have a common platform to share their concern and their question and their criticism to the government. A second project, a fourth project that I want to talk about is a project that we have actually done in Indonesia. It was a pilot project. I don't know if any of you is familiar with the West Kalimantan area in Indonesia. It's an area where there are a lot of there are different type of indigenous population, and they live entirely out of the natural environment. Huge corporation that, specifically corporation that deals with palm oil, are basically grabbing their land and destroying the environment. And what this is also creating is conflicts in between these different ethnic groups that have always lived very peacefully in that area. Now, one of the biggest problems is that because of the huge impact that the big corporations are having on the environment, there are a lot of natural disasters that are happening, including a lot of floods, because they are destroying all the trees. And so whenever it rains now, there's nothing that can actually keep the water within the soil and everything gets flooded. The local population doesn't know how to deal with it because they've never had to deal with it. And so they accuse each other, and that's what increased tensions and conflict in between the different groups. We decided to create a system where we said, well, what these people basically need is information. They need to be able to exchange information with each other so they know what's happening and they know how to deal with it. So that if someone is driving in a road and the road is flooded, they have someone to tell them that they should take another one. Or if there is, for example, a demonstration against a corporation, everybody knows that there is a demonstration in that area and they can join that demonstration. Because another problem that they had was the ability to coordinate their civil actions against the big corporations. So the system was built in two pieces. One was SMS-based system, and it was very simple. Everybody could send an SMS to a simple centralized point saying, this is happening in my area, or I have this question, can anyone answer to that? There was an administrator that will edit the message to make sure that there were no hate speech or anything like that. And then the message was automatically sent to all the subscribers. Now, if it was a question, everybody had the ability to respond to that question. If it was an answer, everybody knew what the answer to that question was. If it was just an information alert, then everybody had that information. The second part of the system was to address specifically literacy in that area, and so it was an IVR system. I don't know if anyone is familiar with an IVR is. Basically, you know, you all have a mobile phone. When you call your mobile provider, you have a very annoying automated voice that tells you, press one if you want to do this, press two if you want to do that. That's an IVR system, interactive voice response mechanism is called. So we created the same system. It was an automatic voice menu. People could call a number, and voice would tell them, press one if you want to record your message, press two if you want to listen to other people's messages. An editor would go through the messages and make sure that they make sense and there was no hate speech or insults or anything like that. And then those messages were automatically available for everybody that could call that number and listen to what other people did. Again, to me, what is fascinating about this project is, again, the fact that it's people talking to people. It's the idea that within communities, you have people that have questions, but 99% of the time, you also have people that have the answers to those questions. And using technology to create systems that help them getting in contact with each other, it's a very powerful way to support communities to be resilient, but also to make their own decisions and being able to actually have enough information to make those decisions. This is a project I was absolutely not involved with, and I don't want to take any credit about, but I thought it was particularly fascinating for me, is the Nawat platform that was set up after the Tunisian Revolution, or actually during the Tunisian Revolution. One of the things that was fascinating to me is that it was a very simple blog, a political blog talking about Tunisia. The majority of the people writing on it were diaspora, which means they were Tunisians that lived outside the country because of their political involvement and sometimes just because they've left the country. When the revolution started, they started using their blog and their website to basically collect every single piece of information they could get out of the country. You could find videos taken by people with their mobile phones during the night. You could find maps that would show you different attacks. You could find tweets and Facebook status. Everything was translated either in French or in English and available for everybody to see. I was following very closely the Tunisian Revolution, and I was impressed by the fact that every morning you would log in and you would see basically a chronicle of everything that happened that night, minute by minute, in every single city in Tunisia. The ability that these people had and the network that they had on the ground and the technology that allowed them to gather this information from everywhere was incredible to watch. I'm going to skip that and I'm going to go to the last example, which is Kyrgyzstan. Not a lot of people have heard about Kyrgyzstan because it's not a country that has a lot of oil or diamonds or anything that is particularly important for the international community. It is actually a country that has had conflicts for a very long time and still has it. The biggest one is in between the Uzbek and the Kyrgyz population. It's a Muslim country, very, very secular. You will not see women that cover their head. Everybody drinks alcohol. I've been there and I've worked there and I find it one of, it's if you don't know that it's a Muslim country, you would not realize that it's a Muslim country until you see a mosque or you actually see people going to pray. One of the things that it's though particularly bad about Kyrgyzstan is that despite the apparent democratic system that they have, the country is, and especially the government, is extremely corrupt. And the conflict that broke up the last time in 2011 saw extreme violence being perpetrated against the minority of Uzbek. One of the things that had happened in 2008 was that Kyrgyzstan signed and ratified the Convention Against Torture. Now, that didn't really mean that they stopped torturing people. Actually, they were torturing people heavily, and not just within the framework of the conflict in between Uzbek and Kyrgyz, but also the police and the national security was using torture as a normal way to deal with issues and problems of criminalities. Now, this local organization created a crisis mapping system, basically, using an interactive map very similar to the one that we used in Egypt for the parliamentary elections. And they started collecting anonymous information from people that would report about torture being perpetrated to them. Now, this also came and was set up in the same time in which the government decided to set up a commission for monitoring the actual implementation of the law against torture. So the reason why they created this was not just to allow people to report directly and in an anonymous way, not to a government agency, because people were scared about reporting to a government agency, but it was also done to show, or at least to force and to push, the national agency that it's supposed to monitor torture to actually do their job. Because in the moment in which you see reports being posted here and people talking about what happened to them, the commission is in no position to say, we have not eyewitnessed anything and there's no problem and there's no torture happening on in the country. So in a way, this was both a way for people to report, but also a very strong advocacy tool to show to the world that if the agency is not saying that torture is happening, they're probably covering up for the government. Now, the last thing I want to leave you with is, I know that I've been told that I should talk only about the very positive part of using technology for freedom of speech, but I thought I would not do really my job if I didn't leave you with a bunch of questions about what it means to use technology for freedom of speech. One is definitely the digital gap. We still have a majority of the world that it's not online and does not have access to those tools. The infrastructure and the policy, we're talking about a tool, which is, for example, the internet, that relies on an infrastructure that is still a physical infrastructure, meaning that it's set on a piece of land that belongs to someone and it's controlled by someone, 99% of the time, the government. So we can't necessarily always talk about the free internet, because it may be free in the sense that we don't pay for it, but it's set up in an infrastructure that it's controlled by someone. And of course, the difference in between listening and engaging, and you know, we can't just say that we're free because we can say something. We have to think about that being free also means that when we say something, someone is listening to us, because otherwise it's not really freedom for me. And then of course, the fact that new tools like the internet and social media are really bringing new rules. And we have to understand those, what the new rules are or what we want them to be. Thank you.
Right. I'll stand up because that way I can see who's falling asleep. It's a bit too late for some people, I think. Put a tie on. That's so that you wouldn't realize how fat I am. I'm going to be talking about something that's rather less serious on the surface from what we've just heard. I'm talking about computer games. In fact, because we're talking about the internet, I'm talking about internet-based computer games, a particular sort called, variously, virtual worlds, or massively multiplayer online role-playing games, or if you don't like that because it's too long, MMORPGs, or if you don't like that because it's too long, MMOs. And these are online shared spaces. So the best known examples are probably World of Warcraft, which has about 6.5 million players now, from a high of over 12 million back in about 3 or 4 years ago. Second Life, which never had that many players and is now trundling along. But there are many of these games. There are huge numbers of people play them, particularly in the Far East, but not just the Far East, they're across the world. The way they work, if you've not seen one, is on your screen there's a picture of a world. It's usually a fantasy style world. It doesn't have to be. There are superhero worlds and there are horror worlds and so on. Mainly fantasy, a bit of science fiction. So you see what's on the screen and you're represented by a character that's in that virtual world. So there's a person in the world and that's you in the virtual world. Sorry, do you want to see the guy a bit closer?
Yeah.
Right. Now, I mentioned World of Warcraft. That's been out for about 10 years now. People are still making them. There's one that's recently out called Wildstar. The people who wrote Wildstar they'd seen World of Warcraft. They knew it was what it was going to be like. They started working on Wildstar and they made this game. So they kind of took World of Warcraft and made a better version of it. But it was essentially World of Warcraft is its ancestor. Now, the people who made World of Warcraft didn't just think of World of Warcraft out of nowhere. They had previously played a game called EverQuest, which was big around 2000, that kind of time. And the people who played EverQuest hadn't just thought of it. They'd played a game called Dikumud. Dikumud and EverQuest are pretty much the same, except EverQuest had graphics and Dikumud was all text. So Dikumud would describe the room in words and EverQuest would show it on the screen. Well, apart from that, the gameplay is pretty much identical. Now, Dikumud, if there are any Danish people in here, you'll be able to say what Dikumud, basically the Data Logic Institute of Copenhagen University. That didn't come from nowhere. The people who wrote Dikumud had previously played a game called Abermud, which came from Aberystwyth University in the UK. And Abermud wasn't a gift from the gods, that came from a game called Mud, a multi-user dungeon, which was a gift from the gods, because that was written by two people, Roy Trubshaw and Richard Bartle. That's me. This is why I'm giving this talk and you're not. So, Mud. From Mud, you can do this for virtually any of the virtual worlds. You can trace their history back to Mud. Now, there were other people who had the same idea, and they also made some games, and some of those have got feeds into the current world state. I mean, creating a virtual world wasn't an act of genius. Obviously, I am a genius, but this isn't evidence of it. But nevertheless, they all come from Mud. Now, you'd have thought that if I'd invented a multi-billion-dollar-a-year industry, I would be actually delivering this talk from my yacht anchored off the Bahamas, but no, I'm here. Now, why am I here talking rather than being immensely wealthy? Well, it's because of the reason that Roy and I wrote Mud. This was back in the 1970s in England, and people like me didn't go to university in the 1970s in England because we were working class. England's got a very class-based system. Oxford, where we are now, rich people and foreign despots send their children to study at Oxford. If you come to Oxford, you've got a passport for life. For the rest of your life, you've got a way of... it opens doors to you because there's an immense amount of privilege here. I was never going to get to go to Oxford or to Cambridge. The reason I got to go to the University of Essex, which is where I did go, was because they had a computer science course. And if you're a middle-class person back then, you didn't want to send your child to study computer science because that's tech. Our children are more educated than that. We wanted to see law, medicine, or art, politics, these kind of things, where they can go and be journalists, and then they can and be lawyers, and they can run companies and tell computer scientists what to do. So they were prepared to allow some very smart people to study computer science if they had they weren't from the right kind of backgrounds. So there was nobody on my course at all who was in any way middle class. We were all pretty well the first people who'd ever been to university from our particular backgrounds. And computer science was regarded as the lowest of the low. Nobody would study that. It's not serious at all, like psychology. So we leave one class system, we get into university, we still find that we're at the bottom. We can't date girls. We can't date the girls who are computer scientists. That's the thing you didn't... back then, computer scientists were... We regarded people as people. So... You'd say, who do you know? Well, I remember Kevin, because Kevin was the big afro hair guy with the dark glasses, really cool. I remember Roy, because he was quite tall. I remember Gail, because she was a girl. I remember Nigel, because he had kind of a hooked nose. And I remember, it was like a physical characteristic. You just treated people as people. And you wouldn't hit on somebody for being a girl, because they were a friend. You know, so we never didn't have any social skills or anything. And it was awful. And we raged against this. The world sucked, so we made a better one. We made a world of our own invention we called called MUD, multi-user dungeon. Because if the real world sucks, you make a better one. Now, the problem we had there, of course, was that back then the computer we would use, it was in a room slightly bigger than this one, and it was almost as powerful as Google Glass. So, you know, it wasn't really all that powerful a machine at all. But it was the DEC System 10, it was one of the most powerful machines we had at the time. So we built this world. We called it a game. We always thought of it as a game because it had the conceit that a game has. See, when you're playing, you're agreeing to abide by a set of rules that moderate your behavior. And when you accept those rules, you get freedoms that you didn't have if you didn't accept the rules. So if you and I were playing chess and it's my move first, I say, oh, I'll just take your king. Well, that's physically possible. There's no rules in the universe that stop doing that. I mean, it's not like I was saying, I'll incinerate it with my laser eyes, but I wouldn't want to make people know I could do that. But you obey the rules, and this is it's called the magic circle in game studies. So within the magic circle, you're obeying rules that you could actually disobey if you really wanted to, but by all following the rules, you get an experience which is better than if you didn't constrain yourself. So it's a bit like acting. If I was to stand here and make a racist remark, well, actually, I probably could do it because I've just enquoted it. But if I just made a casual racist remark, people would be looking at me strangely. But if I was standing on a stage playing a character who made a racist remark, I would be surrounded by this bubble, this frame, which allows me to act in ways which I couldn't do normally. Likewise, if I went up and punched someone in the face, they wouldn't. I'd be hauled away. But not if I was in a boxing ring. Even though offence against a person is one of the things that's in the human rights. You're not allowed to do that. It's one of the fundamental human rights. You're not offences against the person. So there are some ways which games can get round what's in the real world. So we made our game, and it was all about freedom. Freedom to be yourself, or to become yourself if you don't know who you are. And people would play the game, they would play as a character. To start off with, the character would be like a puppet that they would control. And the character would get killed or something, they'd start another one. But after a while, they'd start to identify with the character. So instead of the character being a puppet, it becomes like your representative. And then a bit more, it stops becoming your representative, it starts becoming your representation. It's reflecting different facets of your personality. You find out how to interact with people. You find out what works, what doesn't work. If it doesn't work and you make a terrible faux pas or people hate you, buy with that character, start a new one. And eventually, you become your character. Your character becomes you. You're playing in this world where you are now free. It's like you've self-actualized in this virtual world. Now, MUD was always about freedom, and the people who played MUD wrote their own worlds, took that part of the culture with them, because they played the game, so they were on board. So they also made their games about freedom, and so on and so on. It's carried on through the culture. Now, today's MMO developers who weren't even alive when we wrote MUD, they're still making worlds where you get to be free, where you get to go into the world, role play they call it, but it isn't role playing, it's actually exploring your own self. So in a virtual world, you can do things that are separate from the real world. If you think the real world sucks because the real world doesn't like the fact you're ginger-haired, wear glasses, female, lesbian, oh sorry, female and lesbian. I play as Polly. So yeah, you can do this. When we first started off, the other people who were my friends, they were playing the game, but they were still playing as themselves. You know, a bit like when you in Second Life, when they had the IBM people going and they're standing in Second Life wearing the IBM uniforms and little IBM badges, and well, you're not really role-playing there, are you? That's just you. So they weren't really getting on board. But I'd played some Dungeons & Dragons. I knew about the role-playing gave you this conceit. So I did actually create a character called Polly, female character. Originally it was a parrot. I was using it for debugging purposes. I just said a word and then it repeated it back. But eventually I created, I expanded it and made it into a female character, so I could play as a female character. Everybody knew I wasn't a female in real life because they were all in the university. And they, but hold on, he's playing a female character, but he's not female, whoa. Now, okay, yeah, some people would probably say something like, you know, he's gay or something, but I don't really care because so what? I'm not. But anyway, so I created these characters, but people saw that, and then some of them obviously created female characters if they were male or male if they were female. It tends to be more male to female than female to male, but for reasons I can explain, but not right now. But other people started exploring being other things, like I'll go in and I'll start behaving badly, or I'll go in there and I'll start behaving super kindly or helping people out. And through this, we developed, people came to understand what worked for them as part of their personality. Now, you mentioned player types. How long have I got? Nah. 3 minutes. Okay. Let's not talk about player types, because I've only got 3 minutes. But moving on. It's getting to the stage now where it costs $25 million at least to make a virtual world, but not for long. Because we know from the old text days that once people have made game engines, you can release them into the world and anybody can run it. We're seeing it a bit with Minecraft. There's a main Minecraft server, but anybody can get a Minecraft server and make their own Minecraft world. Soon you'll be able to make your own virtual world, and you can allow anybody you want into that. Anybody you don't want, you can keep out. Whether you want them in or out is up to you. That's a freedom of speech on the part of the designer, the developer, you. But you can create spaces which are separate from the real world, which people from you don't care where can go into there and be. And this is a sense of freedom that you get from virtual realities. You essentially become a god. You have your own reality, which is better than the reality that you find yourself in. This is why, by the way, if you're, if anybody ever says they want to go to heaven, say, no! Because whenever you make a virtual world, it's better than the one that you live in. So if there is a god, then heaven really sucks, because otherwise it wouldn't have made a sucky world like this. So you can make your own world, you can be the god of your own world, whether you want to be a hands-on god or whether you just want to be a god who go in, have fun, I'll go and create another world. It's up to you. But it gives people the freedom. That's what they were always, always about, the freedom. And that's why, even though I'm white, male, and stale, as they say these days, if I hadn't have been in that position I was all those years ago, raging against being brought up in the middle of nowhere, finally getting to university and finding it even worse, then I would never have created that world. It would have been created by someone who commercialized it in America, as happened 3 times, and we would never have had the freedom we've got now. Okay, so I think I've rambled on enough and got angry enough.
Which I don't know if it's a kind of hazard of your job, but yeah, you've all sort of slightly become game characters now. So I'm really keen that we have as open a discussion as possible. I've obviously got lots of questions that I would like to ask, so I'm just going to kick off some discussion with the panel and then I'll open it out to questions. We've had, I think, a lot of discussion about the sort of democratic power, if you like, that the digital world in all of its forms affords. So from virtual realities to citizen journalism to the sharing of information. And one of the things that you raised was around access. So I just wanted to talk with our glass half full hats on about how you think we can get to a position where this is genuinely a democratic
Well, I mean, as I said, the internet, it should be seen as a, and the digital world in general should be seen through a dialectical lens. And I mean by that it could be used either way. It could be used as a very powerful tool to spreading fanaticism and violence and hatred and intolerance. But it could also be used as a very powerful tool for spreading the ideas of free thinking and free inquiry and skepticism, etc. And I think it cannot be detached from the traditional way of doing politics, basically. I mean, we needed a Thomas Paine and a Thomas Jefferson to create a constitution for the United States. And I think that the virtual world is kind of similar. It's a new territory. And without the brains and goodwill of good people believing in an ideal, coming together and walking the walk and making the effort in articulating those principles in a very clear way and combating anti-liberal ideas, if you want, with good arguments, I don't think we can reach that that point. So it's a political struggle.
So you mentioned Paine and Jefferson. Who might those people or those groups be in the 21st century? Where do you see that impetus coming from?
Well, I've been involved through Global Voices in I mentioned internet governance. That's, for most people, it's a very boring subject because the IGF in particular, the Internet Governance Forum, which is supposed to be the one platform that brings everybody together, the civil society, the private sector, and the and governments, to try to articulate a way to govern the Internet. And that's the political battle that I'm talking about. Unfortunately, that's where we should be investing our time if we want to make sure that the internet stays as open and as equal, which is not guaranteed at all. I mean, it could go either way, as I said. Most of the time, actually, in those platforms, what happens is that people who masquerade as civil society are actually government-sponsored groups or people who lobby for very narrow and private interests, who show up because they have the money, show up in those platforms and defend very narrow-minded ideas. But most of activists like ourselves who have a broader outlook of life and want to defend a certain way of living and living together, feel bored by these questions, and I find it really unfortunate. So, I mean, it is fundamentally political. The internet in most of those countries where people suffer from oppression, from religious extremism, etc., the internet remains, in most of those cases, the only way for people to express their ideas. Traditional media has been taken over. The government doesn't represent them. The private sector works hand in hand with the government. Those governments export technology that is most of the time made in the West in countries that are supposedly democratic and use it to curtail and stifle people. So there is a battle there. There is an effort to be made.
And a lot of the projects you're doing are very much community-based projects. So they rely heavily on people having some kind of access to technology and ability to use it. So in a sense, the sort of free expression right also becomes an access right. How do you develop that? How do you make sure that people are then able to use this technology, get access to that technology, so that they can express themselves freely?
I mean, that's the $1 million question, right?
Someone. Could you just answer it now? Well,
of course. We actually had it's an ongoing conversation in the ICT4D world. Is internet a human right? Is access to the internet a human right for people? And to be honest, I think that there are some very good you know, reasons to say yes, it should be, and I think there also are on the other side some very good reasons that advocates for the no answer have. One is, of course, saying, well, then if there is the access to the internet, there is also the access to mobile, then there is also a human right, the access to, you know, a cooking stove, is there also the access to having a car? When do we decide that the human right is the access to a specific tool? On the other side, of course, a lot of people say, well, actually, the internet is not just like a tool like everything else. It's something that right now it allows you to do things that no other tool allows you to do. And if government or institutions or, you know, whatever type of authority are using that as a way to either suppress or give other rights to people, then not having access to it, it automatically denies you access to a lot of other things. So I do believe that this, you know, without going into the discussion, yes, it's a human right, not it's not a human right, I do believe that we have to work, and there's tons of organizations around the world that are actually working for giving more connectivity to people. IDEO is one of those organizations. They go into lots of different countries and set up fiber optics or internet connectivity. There are huge projects that are being done to create, for example, low-cost mobile towers. There's one that it's a project from Vodafone, I think, that has been done in DRC, where they managed to create a mobile tower that cost around $10,000 to $15,000, which is extremely cheap, and they can set it up in the middle of the jungle so that people that live there have access to a mobile network. So I do believe that the access to whatever means of connectivity, which may be the internet or mobile or sometimes other type of connectivities, is something that a lot of organizations and even increasingly the United Nations, for example, are identifying as something absolutely fundamental. It's in a way, it's becoming even more important than other type of support to communities because, again, the ability of people to communicate and to receive or send information is almost as important as their ability to have food or shelter or to access specific type of goods, if you want.
Can you make dark in here? Is it possible to have the lights on?
Sorry. Off.
Off or on?
On.
Is there a light? I don't know if there is, actually. I didn't see it. Or maybe.
Suddenly everyone's getting feeling a bit dull, sorry. Richard, just a quick final question before we go to the audience. One of the things that struck me when you were talking was sort of the sense that I think often we talk about digital and we think about citizen journalism or we think about community projects. When you were talking, I was having much more of the sense of the creativity that one, or the kind of the freedoms that one associates with literature or poetry. And do you think that's something that talk about enough, that sort of creativity that is unleashed by digital gaming and
no, we
arts.
Don't. We don't talk about it enough because games are regarded as a low form of entertainment. And until the people who are currently elected all die and are replaced by people who grew up playing games, we're going to be stuck with it. Back in the 1920s, Britain had a really good film industry, but we don't now. Why don't we now? Because the government, once other countries started giving subsidies, the British government decided to give subsidies to make documentaries, because obviously film is a lower form of education, but entertainment, but documentaries are education. And we see that now the government will fund people who are going to make educational games, but not who are going to make games that are fun. So, okay, Hollywood ate our lunch. We now go and watch all the Hollywood movies, very few British ones, but we do make damn good documentaries until David Attenborough dies. Now, the thing is, games are an art form. And when people say to me, you know, the internet's a tool it can be used for good or evil, well, that's true. It can be used for good, it can be used for evil. What about games? Well, games are an art form. The designer of the game is attempting to articulate something which they cannot articulate in another medium, because why would you spend months writing a game if all you had to do was spend weeks writing a poem or choreographing an interpretive dance or however else you want to express yourself? People make games at heart because they want to say something, and if you want to know what it is that they're saying, you have to play the game because that's the only way they can articulate it. So games are an art form. So if you ask, are games a force for good or a force for evil, then you're kind of asking, is art a force for good or a force for evil? And in general, art, is highly, highly privileged, and people would be very reluctant to say that art is can be used propaganda, obviously, but art, you know, is pure and so on, and therefore it must be a force for good, because ultimately people get to express themselves. Now, another thing I would say is a lot more people are able to create than we think. So you look back in history and you see all these artists, wonderful. So Florence managed to produce Michelangelo and Leonardo da Vinci and Botticelli, all these people, just out of our little city, how many people lived there? 10,000 at the time? But because they had the opportunity to create, they did. Now, right now, people have the opportunity to create. The problem is that even if you were to sit down and write the world's most brilliant novel, no one's going to know you did it, because everybody creates, and most of what they create is garbage. And it really is not worth reading or playing or anything else in. But the stuff that is good, that you really think, that does say something, that does speak to me, that you aren't going to find it, because there's a million games on the iPad, and that one might be number 450,000 in the list. You have to click down a bit to get to it. So, yeah, good and bad.
You've just been talking about my
novel
there. Sorry, by the way, about the wobbling. I think it might be some elephants jumping on the ceiling. I'm not quite sure why that's happening. So, it's your turn to freely express yourself, although I would encourage you to do so as a question, if possible.
Yes, Richard, I'd like to know if there has been any research looking into who's playing these games, from which countries, and how are they playing these games, what kind of figures are they creating, and are they all moving in the same direction, and things like that.
What about self-publishing? What was in your case, like Second Life, that is created by the creator, and maybe in your case, the people talk to each other, but are they actually doing something artistic or something creative? Possibly, I don't know. Self-publishing.
So is that self-publishing, what do we think of it,
What do you think of it, what use of it, is it actually used?
So there's a question about who's playing the games, who's creating the games, and also about self-publishing more generally. Which do you want to keep up?
Yeah, okay, I'll answer the who's playing the game ones. Yes, they do know who's playing the games. There are vast amount numbers of players, as in hundreds of millions, out in the Far East. Even as early as like 2004, 50% of the population of South Korea had played a massive multiplayer game called Lineage. It'd be hard to find 50% of the population of England who had played chess. But 50% of the population of South Korea, which is 40 million people there, have played. So it's huge out there in the Far East. It's also big in the West, but we've got more games, and there's been a shift in revenue model. So it's a bit harder to find out who's, because people are being recorded twice because they're playing several games. When they were only subscribing, and typically they only subscribed to one, but now they can play many for free, so you don't really know how many there are. But we do know things about demographic breakdown, for example. Most games would be played by males. It depends on the game, but we 10 to 20% female, with the rest male, as in self-identified when they fill the forms in, and I'm sure you get some intersex and so on. But the ages, they're far more mature than you would get playing first-person shooters, because they tend not to be reflex-based games, but they're not as mature as the match three games that people play for fun at the bus stop while they're waiting. You get people in their 60s and 70s playing those kind of games. So they're more like in the late 20s, early 30s, up to 40s. That's where the curve lies, although there is quite a lot in the teenage years. So it addresses a different audience, and there are reasons for that, and that's to do with the fact that through playing the game, these games, you can, this is a 2-hour lecture, so I'll just basically summarize it. Playing these games, you get to self-actualize, you get to figure out, to understand who you are as a person, because you're going on a hero's journey, in effect.
I don't know which of you are, I don't know if you want to talk about the self publishing. I mean, there is a sort of, I suppose we've all referenced it in slightly different ways around the kind of volume of information that can be shared on the internet, and often the issues that can present in terms of working out what's true, what's opinion, what's good, what's bad. I mean, do you have any sort of thoughts about the advantages?
I can say my opinion is that it depends really on the tool that it's being used and on the group of people that it's involved. I've seen, for example, on certain type of tools like Twitter, for example, there is what it's called self-regulating mechanism. That, for example, there's a very interesting article, if you go online, you'll probably find it, talking about that phenomenon during Sandy, the hurricane that hit the United States, Washington DC, and then New York. There were a lot of rumors going around on Twitter, photos that had been photoshopped, and a lot of different pictures that had been also photoshopped. One of the things that they noticed was that throughout the course of the time, the entire community on Twitter was very quickly able to detect the rumors and the false information and push those information out of the discussion. The same thing, for example, there's an amazing project done by The Guardian looking at the volume of information produced during the London riots in 2011. They did visualization of how fast rumors would explode on Twitter and how fast the counter information kicked out the rumors over time. And it's a very good visualization because if you look at it, it really shows the self-regulating mechanism, where the whole community, in a way, basically managed to put pieces together, because it's a huge conversation until they figure out that's a rumor, that's a false information out of it. But then, for example, in a lot of the projects that I've been talking about, it's more about the community, and it's very small communities sometimes. In that sense, I feel that it's more, I want to have a good information, so I'm gonna deliver a good information. So it's more about people know what the system is built upon, and they know that if they insert something wrong or not right within that system, they will get something that is not right. And because they understand the usefulness of that information for them, they also provide a good information.
Well, in my case, working for Global Voices, we are following a couple of bloggers around the world and a couple of projects, citizen media projects, citizen journalism projects, investigative projects in some cases, and sometimes we support a couple of those projects. And I mean, surely there is a problem with the deluge of information out there. That's a problem. I mean, the problem with the internet is it's very noisy. I mean, you get a lot of information. It's really difficult actually to make a sense of what is true, what is not true. Is there disinformation out there? Of course there is. Is there propaganda out there? Of course there is. And that's a real danger, actually. But what I have been actually observing in the last years, in the last 2 years or so, actually, and somehow it started prior to the revolution in Tunisia, is the emergence of what I would call the people's news agencies, if you like. A couple of people come together, they agree that there is a lot of disinformation, that there needs to be somebody to aggregate, curate, contextualize, and then feed that information, contextualized, and make a sense of the information, and then give it to the world somehow. And there are more and more of those now emerging, and we've seen one example is Nawet, actually. Nawet has been wonderful, actually. They've been doing a tremendous job during the revolution in Tunisia. There was a lot of misinformation and disinformation. The former regime tried to kind of poison the well, and they were sending kind of rumors and stuff about people, character assassination, and treating this guy of crimes that were never committed, etc. Same happened in Egypt as well. They went into the business of vilifying people. The same happens with Islamists as well. I mean, as somebody, as an activist, expresses the beginning of some kind of doubt or or secular leaning, I mean, they become the target of misinformation and disinformation. And those groups actually make, now emerging, do a kind of a public service now. And some people make money out of it, because you can then sell that curated, aggregated, cleaned up information to mainstream media, and then inject those resources back into the system and create some kind of a...
Hisham, I'm just keen to take a few more questions.
Sure.
We've got about 10 minutes. So the question here, gentleman here, and then a lady in a very nice bright colored top over there.
I'm really interested if you could talk about how countries start to take control of the plumbing of the internet, and they try and start to regulate it in the way that they previously regulated broadcasting, which was unregulated in the early days, how that will affect these kind of crowd operated networks, particularly I think the publishing case where we saw in Russia now that they're saying over a certain number of people, it's publishing, we want to regulate it.
Right.
It's no longer free.
Right.
How that will be countered and how that will affect the response to emergencies?
First, just thank you for very interesting aspects of the digital world. But you're speaking about a digital age that is in its minors. Can you speculate anything about what will happen in the next 10 years?
Four different personality types of gamers. Well, should we come to that bit at the end? So that, regulation, because we are seeing, as with Russia, for example,
right.
If you've got to over 3,000 followers, you suddenly become a formal publisher, and then there's a form of regulation. Is that something that concerns you?
Definitely. Very quickly, I've been following those trends recently. I mean, Russia is a case in point for sure. And they are trying to prosecute people or kind of regulate the internet in a way. But I'm not as concerned about those things, because you can always anonymize yourself. They're not flawless, but you can always, I mean, the thing about the internet is that you can hide behind the pseudonym. I myself actually use a pseudonym. I'm not using my real name for reasons that you can imagine, but that's a way, and there are many other ways. There is what we call, in this sphere of activists, liberation technology. There is a technology that has been developed to try to protect you online. But what really concerns me is surveillance. That's the name of the game right now. It's a multi-billion dollar market, and all those governments, including here in Britain, are investing public money, buying this technology. And as A.C. Graylin said the other day, I mean, self-censorship, that's something to fear. Because when you think that somebody is looking over your shoulder, you start self-censoring, and there is nothing that can
We're in glass half full mode, so we're going to take the idea.
Yeah, I mean...
We're aware of the surveillance, because obviously that was talked about yesterday as well. Let's think about the future. The gentleman here asked, what might the future look like? We're in our infancy of the internet. What might it look like in the future?
I do believe that in the future, almost everybody will be connected, to be honest. I see connection growing everywhere, even in places where I would have never imagined people would never even had the mobile phones. And seeing that, because I work for a long time in Africa, in a lot of places, I see people that barely have electricity, but they do have a mobile phone. So to be honest, I do see in 10 years from now, everybody being connected. But I also do see, to reconnect with the previous question, there is a huge struggle that will become bigger and bigger, which is the struggle for controlling the infrastructure that allows people to connect. And that's, I think that this is like where we are talking about a huge role that civil society organization is now playing, and we really should be looking at what civil society organizations are doing in our countries, because there is a huge battle that is being fought about really trying to set up systems where governments or private companies cannot have control over the infrastructure of the internet, and so cannot control that conversation, because then we will end up in a place where everybody has access to it, but we're not really able to say whatever we want on it, because someone can shut us down in the same way they shut us down in person.
Yeah, so there's a kind of freedom to express yourself, as someone said, I think, on Friday, but not freedom after you've expressed yourself. Richard, four personality types. Quickly.
Oh, okay. This is, they aren't personality types. What they are is how people get fun when they play games. Originally, when people made a game, they would make a game that they personally wanted to play. So they were essentially players making games that they wanted to play. As a game designer, I didn't see that this was what it should be. What they should be is making games that people want to play. Because otherwise, every game for a five-year-old boy has to be made by a five-year-old boy. I mean, it's ridiculous. Game designers have to understand who is playing their games. And this is, so they need to empathize with them. They need to understand who it is. And all these things you say, well, you know, games for women should only be made for by women. No, games for women should be made by people. That's what they should be made by people, not by women, except that women are people. I mean, it's a category mistake. Games are made by people. If you want to make it for a particular subcategory of person, whether it's, you know, women, children, tortoises, or anything, I mean, you can make the game designer has to understand who's playing it. Now, for virtual worlds, MMOs, I had noticed that there were four types of people who played these games. The people who played these games have four different types of fun. Okay, first person's killers. These are people who get their fun from annoying other people. Not that there are any Scottish people this morning in the Richard Dawkins who I would classify as that. They're basically pepper. You want a little bit of pepper, but you don't want the whole pepper pot. So a bit of pepper so that it gets people to talk about things that they might not otherwise have done, but you don't want a whole lot of killers. The next ones are explorers. These are people who like to find things out, explore, they find information. They go deep into how things work, they go broad into how much there is. After that, we've got achievers. These have got goals. They're trying to, basically in a game context, they're trying to win the game. So they're trying to do things, they've got a goal and they're working towards achieving it. And then we've got socializers, and the socializers are the people who are doing it because they want to be connected to other people. Now, that's the basic theory. I mean, as I say, it goes on for 2 hours if you want to pay me, but just stop. but essentially, you can apply that mainly to games, but it does have other aspects. For example, when I was hearing, you know, those people on Hurricane Sandy who were sticking in the photographs of fake hurricanes over New York, they were griefers. They were the killer types. They were in there adding some spikes. The other people reacted to that. And in their reactions, the conversation was taken to places it maybe wouldn't have done without the pokes from the irritating people. So you've got to have some. It's worthwhile thinking of any internet activity in terms of what people are doing it for. Why are they doing it? And if you understand why they're doing it, then you can help promote or help manage the experience they're going to get.
So achievers, explorers, socializers, and killers. Maybe that's a topic to take out into tea and coffee now and find out which of your colleagues is one of those things. I'd just like to thank all of our panelists. North and South School's upstairs for coffee, but I'm told to say to be relatively quick because after that is the plenary session at the Sheldonium. Thank you so much.